بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه ما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is another episode of our weekly series A Dose of Deen, where I focus on du'as from the Quran and Hadith for a better understanding, or perhaps new du'as that we can learn so that we make these du'as to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And secondly, I also focus on common general fiqh-related questions for the benefit of everyone listening. Inshallah, today we will be discussing one particular verse from Surah Aal Imran. Surah Aal Imran is the third surah of the Quran, verse number 16, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. O our Lord, O our Rabb, surely we believe, absolutely we believe. Therefore, forgive us our sins and save us from the punishment of the fire. O our Lord, surely we believe, indeed we believe. Therefore, forgive us our sins and save us from the punishment of the fire. Of course, this particular dua is very similar to the very first dua that we had discussed. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. But this one gives one or two extra details. So number one, we are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us our sins based on the fact that we have bought iman, based on the fact that we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, based on the fact that we believe in the messengership of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So because of that, we are essentially using that as a wasila, as a means of gaining from the mercy of Allah. We are asking from the mercy of Allah, we are petitioning from the mercy of Allah, and this is how we are petitioning, that, O Allah, we have bought iman, we have believed, therefore forgive us our sins. And not only forgiving our sins in this world, but forgive us our sins so that we are saved from the ultimate punishment in the hereafter, which is the punishment of the fire. And even though this might seem to be like a very recurring theme in most du'as, that, O Allah, forgive us, forgive our sins and save us from the punishment of the fire, even in رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ, even though we are asking for the best of the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still teaches us to ask for saving from the punishment of the fire. And this highlights the extreme punishment of Jahannam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us constantly throughout the entire Quran that this is something that you should always ask forgiveness for, and this is something that you should always seek protection against. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq to do so. With regards to the fiqh question, inshallah, for this episode, we will be continuing with the series that we started two episodes ago about salah. In the first such episode 2 weeks ago, I talked about the prerequisites of salah. Last week I spoke about the fara'id, the absolute essentials of salah. And today, inshallah, we are going to be talking about the wajibat of salah. Wajibat of salah. As mentioned before, wajibat is a particular category of fiqh within the Hanafi madhab. It is not something found in the other three madhahib. It is a very technical decision as to why there is a wajib category. But overall, once we go through the wajibat, you will immediately realize that all of these things are things that you already do. And this is just as a refresher. We don't usually have to think of these in terms of categories, but it is useful to know, because once you mistakenly do something, if you leave out something, it is helpful to know what category that action belongs to, so that you know how to correct your mistake. So for example, if you know that something that you did not do is part of the prerequisites of salah, the preconditions of salah, then you know that you cannot even start salah. When it comes to the fara'id of salah, if you know that you left out one of the fara'id of salah, then you know that you have to repeat your salah. And when it comes to the wajibat of salah, according to the Hanafi school, if a person leaves it out on purpose, if they leave it out on purpose, it is sinful and they have to repeat their salah. However, if a person leaves it out by accident, which is what usually happens, then a person must do sajda sahu. Sajda sahu is something that inshallah we will talk about perhaps in the next episode or the episode after that. So for today, we are going to go over the wajibat of salah, and there are 13 specific wajibat. The first one is to say the words Allahu Akbar, as opposed to saying anything else when we start the salah. So this is again something that we already do. We do not say anything else other than Allahu Akbar when we start our salah. Number two, a person reciting the Fatiha as well as a surah or three verses. We talked about reciting the Fatiha last week. So a person following that up with at least three verses. And three verses for most of us is Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. And of course, there are verses in the Quran from other surahs, for example, Thumma abas, Thumma nazar, thumma abasa wabasar, thumma adbara wastakbar, from Surah Muddathir. If a person recites any verses like these, as long as it's three short verses or one long verse, then they have fulfilled this particular wajib. And of course, when it comes to recitation of surahs, it is within the first two rak'ahs of your obligatory prayer. So for example, when it comes to the fard of Fajr, you recite surahs in both rak'ahs. When it comes to the fard of Dhuhr, you recite surahs in the first two rak'ahs. When it comes to the fard of Asr, again, surah only in the first and second rak'ah. In the third and fourth rak'ah, we only recite the Fatiha. When it comes to Maghrib Salah, again, Fatiha and a surah in the first and second rak'ah, and only Fatiha in the third rak'ah. When it comes to Isha, just as how we pray Dhuhr and Asr. And of course, when it comes to Salatul Witr, which according to the Hanafi school is wajib, according to the other schools it's sunnah, then a person has to recite a surah in each of the three rak'ahs. This is for obligatory and wajib prayers. When it comes to sunnah prayers, then a person has to recite surah and in addition to Surah Fatiha in every rak'ah. So whether it's two rak'ahs of sunnah in Fajr, the four rak'ahs of sunnah before Dhuhr Fard, and the two after the Dhuhr Fard, then a person has to recite the Fatiha and another surah. That was number two. Number three, to do the above recitation, to do the recitation specifically in the first two rak'ahs of the obligatory prayer. So this is something that we already do. Number four, to perform sajda with most of your forehead and your nose. In other words, your face, when it is on the ground, the two parts of your face that are in contact with the ground during sajda is, of course, your forehead and your nose. So most of your forehead and your nose is touching the ground. If your head is right above the ground and you are not touching the ground, then that is omitting a wajib. Number five, to perform the second sajda before moving on to other parts of the prayer, right? To perform the second sajda before you either sit for tashahud or before you stand up for the next rak'ah. Number six, to be still for at least a moment in every part of the salah. This is something that we had discussed in a previous episode where I talked about how when it comes to the standing between the two rukurs, and when it comes to the sitting between, when it comes to the standing after the rukur, and when it comes to the sitting between the two sajdas, I talked about how a person has to make sure that they are in the posture for at least a moment. That when they stand up from rukur, at the very least, their back has to be straightened out before they go into sijda. And that when a person comes up from the sijda, they have to sit flat on the ground, as you know, to the best of their ability. If there are physical limitations, they sit as close as possible and they are in that posture for a moment before they move on to before they move on to the next sajda. So one of the wajibat is to be still in the integrals of the salah for at least a moment. Number seven, the first sitting. And the first sitting is only applicable to 3 and 4 raka'ah salahs. So when you are praying dhuhr, the first sitting will be at the conclusion of the second raka'ah. When you are praying maghrib, the first sitting will be at the conclusion of the second raka'ah. But when you are praying fajr, you only have one sitting. So that is your last sitting at the end of the second raka'ah. But the first sitting in the 3 and 4 raka'ah salahs are wajib. A person should not leave that out. If they mistakenly leave it out, and this happens sometimes, you are in sijda and you do not realize that you have to sit down before you are fully standing. Before you are fully standing for the third raka'ah. If you are fully standing for the third raka'ah, then you continue. Then you continue praying and you just do the sajda sahu at the end. However, if you are closer to sitting down, then you sit down. Then you sit down and you do the sitting and you recite the at-tahiyyat. Number 8, to recite the entire tashahud in both sittings. The tashahud is, of course, at-tahiyyatu lillahi wa salawatu wa tayyibatu. You know, some variation thereof. A person has to recite the entire tashahud in both the first and the last sitting. So in dhuhr, for example, in the second and the first sitting, you have to recite the full at-tahiyyat. In fajr, you have to recite the full at-tahiyyat. And something that we already do. Number 9, to say the word as-salam. To say the word as-salam, meaning when you are saying as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, you have to say at least as-salam in order to exit the salah. The words alaykum wa rahmatullah, this is a sunnah. Alaykum wa rahmatullah, this is a sunnah. At the very least, the word as-salam is wajib to say in order to exit the salah. Number 10, to recite the qunut, Allahumma inna nasta'inuka wa nastaghfiruka, and there are other qunuts as well, to recite the qunut in the witr prayer. The witr salah in Isha is wajib according to the Hanafi school, and so is reciting the qunut. Number 11 is specifically with regards to the Eid Salah. The two Eid Salahs, if a person, when they are praying Eid Salah, they have to recite the 6 extra takbirs. The 6 extra takbirs, according to the other schools, it is more than 6. According to the Hanafi school, it is 6 extra takbirs. 3 in the first and 3 in the second. So a person has to recite those extra takbirs. If they leave out any of them by mistake, they do sajda sahu. Number 12, for the imam to recite the Quran out loud in the loud obligatory prayers. In other words, the imam, when they are leading the salah, they have to recite the Quran out loud in Fajr, Maghrib, and Isha. And to do so is wajib. So the imam has to recite the Quran out loud in the loud fard salah, which is Fajr, Maghrib, and Isha, in the first 2 rak'ahs. And lastly, number 13, for both the imam and the person who is praying alone to recite Quran silently in the other rak'ahs of the fard salah. So whether you are praying alone or if you are leading after the first 2 rak'ahs of the salah, you recite the Quran silently. So going through the list, and again, very quickly, just to give you a recap, the first one was saying Allahu Akbar to start the salah. Number 2, to recite a surah or 3 verses, 3 short verses or 1 long verse. Number 3, to do the recitation specifically in the first 2 rak'ahs of the obligatory salah. Right? In other words, that when you are praying dhuhr, in the first and second rak'ah, you recite Surah Fatiha and another surah or another few verses. And in the third and fourth rak'ah, you only recite the Fatiha. Number 4, to perform sajda with most of your forehead and at least the hard part of your nose, at least the tip of your nose. Number 5, to perform the second sajda before moving on to the next part of your salah. Number 6, to be still for at least a moment, for at least a moment in the postures of salah. Number seven, the first tashahud. And this applies to 3 and 4 rak'ah salahs. Number eight, to recite the entire tashahud in both sittings. Whether you are praying 2 rak'ahs, three rak'ahs, or 4 rak'ahs, when you are sitting, you have to recite the tashahud. The at-tahiyyat has to be recited in full. Number nine, to say the word as-salam at the very least in order to exit the salah. In order to exit the salah, at the very least, you say as-salam. And of course, if you have time, which most of us do, and we usually don't omit this, we say alaykum wa rahmatullah as well. Number 10, to recite the qunut in witr. Witr, according to the Hanafi school, is wajib. Therefore, to recite the qunut is also wajib. Number 11, to recite the 3, to say the 6 extra takbirs in the 2 Eid salahs. Number 12, for the imam to recite the Quran out loud in the loud obligatory salahs, Fajr, Maghrib, and Isha. And number 13, last one, for the imam and the one who is praying alone to recite the Quran silently in the other rak'ahs of the obligatory prayers. So hopefully this was of benefit and a sort of revision for you as well. As I mentioned, it's not something that you really, really have to think about. Even when we were talking about the prerequisites and we were talking about the fara'id, and today we talked about the wajibat, you will immediately notice that we do all of these things already. This is part of the entire package of salah, right? But at the end of the day, it is helpful to know the categories simply because sometimes when we do make mistakes, at the very least, you know how to rectify it. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and protect us. May He give us knowledge that benefits us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the ability to pray in the best of ways possible. May Allah accept all of our worship. Wallahu a'lam wa billahi tawfiq. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.